Christmas story, with which we are so familiar, is celebrated around the world, in rich countries and in poor, in war-torn countries and countries where natural disasters have pushed resources to their limits. Tonight's service will try to capture the mood of Christmas and unite us in our worship with others through the celebration of the birth of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Come, Emmanuel. Come, Emmanuel, God with us to be. Come down from paradise and occupy this dirty stable of humanity. Come and live rough, as we do, come and die. Come and be lonely as an orphaned child. Come to where grief is harvested and stored. Come to where empty, aged minds run wild. Come to the hospice and the cancer ward. Come, flee from tyrants as a refugee. Come, be betrayed by those you counted friends. Come and be tortured with no amnesty. Come as the means to justify all ends. Come and be broken like a Christmas toy. Come, be completely human. Then we'll know your sorrow may bring hope of lasting joy. And God above is God with us below.
The sleigh was all packed, the reindeer were fed, but Santa still knelt by the side of the bed. Dear Father, he prayed, be with me tonight. There's much work to do and my schedule is tight. I must jump in my sleigh and streak through the sky, knowing full well that a reindeer can't fly. My sack will hold toys to grant all their wishes. The supply will be endless like the loaves and the fishes. I will fill all the stocking and not leave a track. I'll eat every mince pie that is left for my snack. I can do all these things, Lord, but only through you. I just need your blessing, then it's easy to do. All this is to honour the birth of your Son that was sent to redeem us, your most holy Son. So to all of my friends, least your glory I rob, please, Lord, remind them who gave me this job.
Do 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 The birth of Jesus is announced, Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 33. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Hail, O favoured one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favour with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end."
Thank you. Christmas by John Betjeman. The bells of waiting Advent ring, the tortoise stove is lit again, and lamp oil light across the night has caught the streaks of winter rain in many a stained glass window sheen, from Crimson Lake to Hooker's Green. The holly in the windy hedge and round the manor house, the yew, will soon be stripped to deck the ledge, the altar, font, arch and pew, so that the villagers can say, "Church looks nice on Christmas Day." Provincial public houses blaze, corporation tram cars clang, on lighted tenements I gaze, where paper decorations hang, and bunting in the red town hall says, "Merry Christmas to you all." And London shops on Christmas Eve are strung with silver bells and flowers as hurrying clerks the city leave to pigeon-haunted classic towers, and marble clouds go scudding by the many steepled London sky. And girls in slacks remember Dad, and oafish louts remember Mum, and sleepless children's hearts are glad, and Christmas morning bells say come, even to the shining ones who dwell in safe in the Dorchester Hotel. And is it true, the most tremendous tale of all, seen in a stained glass window's hue, a baby in an ox's stall, the maker of the stars and sea, became a child on earth for me? And is it true? For if it is, no loving fingers tying strings around those tissued fripperies, the sweet and silly Christmas things, bath salts and inexpensive scent and hideous ties so kindly meant. No love that in family dwells, no carolling in frosty air, nor all the steeple-shaking bells can with this single truth compare, that God was man in Palestine and lives today in bread and wine.
Dach yn gweld na'n cliw yn o'r mae cwsg da When Jesus went to Bethlehem, I must say it was odd. I wouldn't have been born that way if I was being God. When Jesus went to Nazareth, he spent 20 years in trade. That's hardly a career in which messiahs will be made. When Jesus picked his followers, a practiced eye could tell. He was plainly inexperienced at hiring personnel. When Jesus wandered Palestine, it was awfully hit and miss. You'll never reach your customers with marketing like this. When Jesus worked a miracle, you don't need a degree to know that healing on the Sabbath will annoy a Pharisee. When he went to Jerusalem, he rode there on an ass. What a PR opportunity, and Jesus let it pass. When he went to Gethsemane, the game was not up yet. There was time for him and Judas to kiss and make it up. When Jesus stood in Pilate's house, he didn't realize that politics is all about the art of compromise. When Jesus went to Calvary, that's the ending of the story. One more tragic hero, death instead of glory. He must have been mad, that's the only way I understand it. When Jesus went to Calvary, you'd almost think he planned it.
Thank you. Oh, but he was a tight-fisted hand, old Scrooge. A squeezing, wrenching, grasping, scraping, clutching, covetous old sinner. Hard and sharp as flint, from which no steel had ever struck out generous fire, secret and self-contained, and solitary as an oyster. The cold within him froze his old features, nipped his pointed nose, shrivelled his cheek, stiffened his gait, made his eyes red, his thin lips blue, and spoke out shrewdly in his grating voice. A frosty rime was on his head, and on his eyebrows and his wiry chin. He carried his own low temperature always about him. He iced his office in the dog days, and didn't thaw it 1 degree at Christmas. External heat and cold had little influence on Scrooge. No warmth could warm, no wintry weather chill him. No wind that blew was bitterer than he, no falling snow was more intent upon its purpose, no pelting rain less open to entreaty. Nobody ever stopped him in the street to say, "My dear Scrooge, how are you? When will you come to see me?" No beggars implored him for a penny, no children asked him what it was o'clock, no man or woman ever once in all his life inquired the way to such and such a place of Scrooge. But what did Scrooge care? It was the very thing he liked. Up in his rooms in the dark, Scrooge went. Darkness is cheap, and Scrooge liked it. But before he shut his heavy door, he walked through his rooms to see that all was right. Sitting room, bedroom, lumber room, all as they should be. A small fire in the grate, spoon and basin ready, and the little saucepan of gruel upon the hob. Quite satisfied, he closed his door and locked himself in. He took off his cravat, put on his dressing gown and slippers and his nightcap, and sat down before the fire to take his gruel. But hark! What was this? A clanking noise. Deep down below, as if some person were dragging a heavy chain over the casks in the cellar. Scrooge then remembered to have heard that ghosts in haunted houses were described as dragging chains. The cellar door flew open with a booming sound, and then he heard the noise much louder on the floors below. Then coming up the stairs. Then coming straight towards the door.
"It's humbug still," said Scrooge. "I won't believe it."
No, nor did he believe it even now, though he looked the phantom through and through and saw it standing before him. He was still incredulous and fought against his senses.
"How now?" said Scrooge, caustic and cold as ever. "What do you want with me?"
"Much," Marley's voice, no doubt about it.
"Who are you?"
"In life I was your partner, Jacob Marley. You don't believe in me, do you?" observed the ghost.
"I don't," said Scrooge.
"Why do you doubt your senses?"
"Because," said Scrooge, "a little thing affects them. A slight disorder of the stomach makes them cheat. You may be an undigested bit of beef, a crumb of cheese. There's more of gravy than of grave about you, whoever you are."
"Hear me," cried the ghost.
"Mercy," cried Scrooge. "Dreadful apparition, why do you trouble me?"
"My time is nearly come. I am here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. A chance and hope of my procuring Ebenezer."
"You were always a good friend to me," said Scrooge.
"You will be haunted," returned the ghost, "by 3 spirits.
Scrooge's countenance fell, almost as low as the ghost's had done.
I think I'd rather not," said Scrooge.
"Without their visits," said the ghost, "you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first tomorrow when the bell tolls 1. Expect the second on the next night at the same hour. the third, upon the next night, when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that for your own sake you remember what has passed between us, Ebenezer Scrooge. Remember, remember.
Ardal Bethlehem. Roedd bygeiliad allan drwy'r nos yn yr awyr o gored yn gofalu am ei defaid. Yn sydyn, dyma nhw'n gweld un o'r angolion yr aglwydd, ac roedd ysblander yr aglwydd fel golau llachar o'i cwmpas nhw. Roedden nhw wedi dychryn am eu bywydau, ond dyma'r angel yn dweud wrthyn nhw, paidwch bod yn ofyn, mae gen i newyddion da i chi. Newyddion fydd yn gwneud pobl ym mhob man yn llawen iawn. Mae eich achubwr wedi cael ei eni heddiw yn Bethlehem, tref y Brenin Dafydd. Ie, am y sair, yr aglwydd. Dyma sut byddwch chi'n ei nabod e. Dewch o hyd iddo, yn fabi bach wedi lapio mewn cadachau ac yn gorwedd mewn cafn bwyd o anifeiliad. Yn sydyn, dyma filoedd o'r angolion eraill yn dod i'r golwg. Roedd fel petai holl angolion y nefoedd yn o'r yn addoli diw. Gygonion ti ddiw yn y nefoedd uchaf. Heddwch ar y ddair islaw a bendith diw ar bobl. Pan aeth yr angolion i ffwrdd yn ôl i nefoedd, dyma'r bygeiliad yn dweud wrth a gilydd. Dewch, gadwch chi ni fynd i'r Bethlehem. I weld beth mae'r oglwydd wedi dweud wrthyn ni sydd wedi digwydd. Felly ffyrddan nhw, a dyma nhw'n dod o hyd i Mair a Joseph a'r babi bach yn gorwedd mewn cafn bwyd o anifeiliad. Ar ôl ei weld, dyma'r bygeiliad yn mynd ati i ddweud wrth bawb beth oedd wedi digwydd a beth wedodd yn angel i wrthyn nhw am y plentyn yma. Roedd pawb glywodd am y peth yn ryfeddu at yr hyn roedd y bygeiliad yn ei ddweud. Ond, roedd Mair yn cofio bawb mynylun ac yn meddwl yn aml am y cwbl oedd wedi cael ei ddweud am ei plentyn. Aeth y bygeiliad yn ôl i'w gwaith gan ganmol a moli diw am bopeth roedden nhw wedi weld a'i glywed. Roedd y cwbl yn union fel roedd yr angel wedi dweud.
Visitors from the east come to Bethlehem. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star and it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people, chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. They then opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to the country by another route.
The readings this evening have served as a reminder to us that the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ is upon us again. Each of the narratives highlights the humilities that Christians show in the worship of their Lord. A humility that reflects the extraordinary gift that God gave to mankind in the birth of his begotten Son, Jesus. The Son of God, born in a lowly stable, who gave so much for so many. Let us leave this evening with the joy of this gift in our hearts, with the earnest desire to share this joy with all whom we touch throughout the festive season and forevermore.